Differentiation is an operation on functions that can be reversed. This inversion has its own name and notation. What is it called? You know what it's called. It is, of course, integration. And this can be thought of, at first, as the inverse of differentiation. This goes under the guise of the indefinite integral. Given a function f of x, we denote the indefinite integral by the integral of f of x dx. That's what that long squiggly s sign means. That's the integral sign. The integral of f of x dx is, simply, the class of functions whose derivative equals f of x. The indefinite integral formally undoes differentiation. That sounds easy, right? Yes, of course. This isn't bad at all. Consider the function 3x squared. What happens when we integrate that with respect to x? Let's see, what function has derivative 3x squared? Of course, it's x cubed. No problem. What about if we want to anti-differentiate cosine of x? The integral of cosine of x dx equals sine of x. I take the derivative of sine, I get cosine. We don't have to use the symbol x, we can use any variable we want. What happens when we integrate 6e to the 3u? Take that function, integrate it with respect to u, what do we get? Let's think. The derivative of e to the 3u is, by the chain rule, 3e to the 3u, but we want 6e to the 3u, so let's put a 2 out in front. 2e to the 3u. Is that the answer? Well, let's check. What's the derivative of 2e to the 3u? 2 times 3, 6, e to the 3u. Yes, that's it. That works fine. And we can keep going with many such examples. Take the function 1 over y. Integrate that with respect to y. What do we get? Log of y. Yes, that's it, of course. All of these are straightforward. But we're forgetting something, aren't we? If we go back to the definition of the indefinite integral, it is the class of functions whose derivative equals f of x. We need all such functions. We've merely picked out particular examples. In each of these cases, we can add a constant, a plus c, to these antiderivatives, and when we differentiate that, the constant goes away. That means that in all these cases, we need to add a plus c. This is more important than you might think. Don't forget that. So now, indefinite integrals, no problem, right? Well, we've managed to do some convenient examples. Not all examples are so nice. Consider log of x. What happens when we integrate that with respect to x? Let's see, what function has derivative equal to log? What would that be? Log squared? No, log squared over 2? No, that's not it either. I'm not sure what function has derivative log of x. We've done trigonometric functions, yes, sine, cosine, no problem. What about secant of x? Let's see, 1 over cosines. What do? I take log of cosine? No, that's not going to work. Chain rule gets in the way. Other functions look easy, not easy to integrate. What's the integral of square root of u squared plus 1 with respect to u? I don't know. It's not at all obvious. And for a final example, consider the integral of e to the minus y squared dy. You might think that can't be so bad. Oh no, that's not an easy integral. We're going to spend time and energy working on that one eventually. But what are we going to do? None of these seem straightforward. Are we going to be able to integrate these functions? Yes, with work. We have to do a lot of work to get to the point where we can do these. We will be able to integrate all of these functions eventually. with a great deal of effort. But before we embark on that, we need to take some time. We need to think more about what integrals are and especially about why we want to do them. Why do we want to anti-differentiate? Why are integrals an important part of calculus? That's what we're going to spend our time on before we turn to the problem of computing integrals.